بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، جزاك الله خير، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So continuing on with the series inshallah, the series of the stories of the prophets. Inshallah we're going to be looking at this week the story of Yunus ibn Matta. Yunus ibn Matta, in which entire chapter in the Quran is named after this prophet, Surah Yunus. And Yunus alayhi salam, his story is mentioned 4 times in the Quran. Twice in these places Allah mentions him by name. Wa inna Yunusa lamin al-mursaleen, that Yunus was verily from the messengers. So he was not only a prophet, he was a messenger, somebody that was sent with a message, somebody that was sent to give the people a message. Not only was wahi revealed upon him. And the other 2 times that Allah mentions him in the Quran, Allah mentions him by his title. Allah says in one instance, Allah says, "Wa then Nun," as we heard in the Salah, "Wa then Nun," the man of the whale, the one who is in the whale. And in another time, Allah says, "Ka sahibil hoot," the companion of the whale. Both similar meaning, the man of the whale or the companion of the whale. This is how Allah referred to him in the Quran. Nabiullah Yunus ibn Matta, he was sent to the people of Nineveh, or how you say in English, Nineveh. And that is an ancient tribe or an ancient people that were in the land of Mesopotamia, or northern Mesopotamia, which is modern day Mosul in Iraq, or Mosul. With regards to Yunus alayhi salam, so he had the mission from Allah Jalla wa'ala to convey the message to his people. And what was that message? The message that was given to all of his brothers. The message that every single prophet was sent down with. And that is, what is that message? Is it to bring about social justice in the world? Is it about not stealing? Is it about respecting your parents? What is that primary message? One of the shabab, let's see if we can answer. What is the message that all the prophets had to give? What was it? Let's let the shabab answer. What was the message or the mission of every single prophet? They had different things that they maybe had in their sharia, but there was one thing that they were all unanimous on. Yeah. Ahsant batal, mashallah, tabarakallah. The worship of Allah. The message of La ilaha illallah, that there is none to be worshipped besides Allah. This was the message of all the Anbiya, of all the Rusul, of all the prophets and messengers. طيب. With regards to Yunus alayhi salam, when he was sent to his people and he called them towards Islam, they had the response of all the other people that came before them. They rebelled. They said, "We don't want this message." They turned away from that message. And he became upset with them after a while, trying to tell them, "Come back." And a period of time went by, and he felt that there was no hope in calling them. And so he said, "Be ready for the punishment of Allah after a certain period of time." Some of the Mufassirin mentioned 3 days. Wait for 3 days, and Allah is going to deal with you. And then he left. And this is why Allah says in the Quran, وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا, when he left his people, مغاضباً, angry, angered by them not accepting the statement of Allah. Now, here it's important to mention, his ghadab, his anger, was not for personal reasons or anything like that. It was genuine anger. Angered by the fact that his people are not listening to La ilaha illallah. They're not coming back to Allah. And so he rushed and he left from his people. And as he left his people and he went away, and we know that obviously he embarked upon the ship, as Allah says, "Wa inna Yunus lamin al-mursaleen idh abaqa ila al-fulk al-mashhun," when he left his people, hurried away from them, fled away from them, and he embarked upon the overloaded ship. Allah calls it here the overloaded ship. And whilst he was embarking upon the ship, his people, when they started to see the signs of Allah Allah guided their hearts in that moment that they saw what was happening and they said, we want to turn back to Allah. And they were scared that the adab of Allah is going to come like the Prophet of Allah has promised them. Imagine, you just heard the Messenger of Allah promise that adab is coming. So of course, naturally they were fearful and scared about what was going to happen. And so they came out. And as mentioned in Surah As-Saffat, وَأَرْسَلْنَاهُ إِلَىٰ مِئَةِ أَلْفٍ أَوْ يَزِيدُونَ. There were 100,000 or more. There were 100,000 and more. Some say 130,000, 120,000. Al-Muhim, there were over 100,000. And every single one of them, they all came out. The men came out, the women came out. They even brought out the children and the animals and the cattle. All the cattle that they had, they bring them all out. And they started to plead for the mercy of Allah. Plead in making tawbah. And this is why Allah says in the Quran, فَلَوْلَا كَانَتْ قَرْيَةٌ آمَنَتْ فَنَفَعَهَا إِيمَانُهَا. That had it not been that a village or a town or a group of people, had they only believed, then their iman would have benefited them. Their iman would have benefited them. As if to say, nobody did this. And this is the sunnah of Allah in His creation. And we talk about, we learn, one of the things we learn about the stories of the prophets is the sunnah of Allah in His creation. And that is why Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِّن نَذِيرٍ إِلَّا قَالَ مُتْرَفُوهَا إِنَّا بِمَا أُرْسِلْتُمْ بِهِ كَافِرُونَ. That Allah says, I've never sent down to any village a warner except that mutrafuha. Who are mutrafuha? The ones that have been given the wealth and the ones who are enjoying the luxuries of this dunya, they are the ones that they don't want this message to proceed. They don't want this message to take over. So they will say, إِنَّا بِمَا أُرْسِلْتُمْ بِهِ كَافِرُونَ. That which you have been sent with, we disbelieve in it. We don't want this message. The sunnah of Allah in the creation. Whenever a warner comes and Allah sends down a messenger to tell the people to come back to Allah, to tell the people to think of the akhirah before the dunya, it is the people of luxury and comfort and wealth that they put other people off. Why? Because they feel that they're going to lose their luxury and their comfort and their dunya. And so here Allah says, had it not been that a qarya or a village or a town, had they not believed so that their iman would benefit them. And then He said, then Allah says in the Quran, إِلَّا قَوْمَ يُونُسَ. Except, Allah makes an exception to the sunnah of His creation. Except for the people of Yunus. لَمَّا آمَنُوا. When they believed, كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُمْ عَذَابَ الْخِزِّ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَتَّعْنَاهُمْ إِلَىٰ حِينَ. That when they believed, we prevented and we stopped the punishment of this world coming upon them, and we gave them an enjoyment until a certain amount of time. Why? لَمَّا آمَنُوا. When they believed. Meaning, and this is what Allah says in the Quran, that what Allah does not want to punish you if you worship Him, if you're grateful to Him. Allah is shakir. Allah is grateful to the one who is grateful to Him. If a person believes and a person turns to Allah, Allah does not want to punish that person. Allah has no need to punish a town or a group of people or an individual when they believe in Him. Because Allah does not do dhulm to anyone. And so here, Allah, it is as if here, although the sunnah of Allah in His creation is that the people always turn away from their messengers, Allah said here there was an exception that the people of Yunus, over 100,000, every single one of them, we're not talking about a few, 90%, 95%, every single one of them, over 100,000 of them, all accepted Iman, all accepted Allah, to show you that it is possible, to show you that it is possible for an entire nation to believe. This is here a case study that has been brought in the Quran to show you that it is possible for everybody to believe. But it is humanity themselves that do wrong to themselves. وَمَا أَنَا بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. Allah says, I do not do any injustice upon my slaves. So here, what happened now, referring back to, and here's an amazing thing to mention here, the fact that Yunus alayhi salam was a man who had many followers. And this does not necessarily, this is a fadl from Allah, but it does not necessitate that you are better than anybody else. Why? Because of the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عُرِضَ عَلَيَّ الْأَنْبِيَا. That I saw all the prophets of Allah. فَجَعَلَ النَّبِيُّ يَمُرُّ وَمَعَهُ الْفِئَامُ. And I saw a prophet, one of the prophets going by, and he had a fi'am, like a big group of people. ويمر والنبي يمر ومعه الرجل. And a prophet would go by, and with him is one man who followed him, one man who accepted his message. والنبي يمر ومعه رجلان. And a prophet would go by, and only two people were following him. Only two men were following him. And then he says, والنبي ليس معه أحد. And a prophet would go by with no followers at all. طيب, I ask you a question now. Somebody from Ummat Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, somebody from the great du'at, may Allah have mercy on those who've passed away, and may Allah preserve those who are alive, who have had maybe thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people accept Islam through them. Is that person from Ummat Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, who has given da'wah to thousands, tens of thousands, maybe hundred thousands, is he better than the Nabi that has no followers at all? No. The Anbiya are better than all of the humanity. So here we see a very clear thing that this world we get in, we're too invested in what? In the results, and we have to see the tangible things. It's all about the results. But Allah on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, He will look at your efforts and your intentions and that which you intended, that which your heart. Allah does not look, Allah is not looking at numbers and all these things. And it's a message that Allah taught the companions. It's not about numbers. It's about the hearts. And that heart of the Nabi is far greater than the one who maybe tens and hundreds of thousands accepted Islam. But no doubt this is also a virtue. We're not saying, we're not belittling that. The da'iyah that, you know, for example, we have Sheikh Ahmed Didat, rahimahullah, thousands and tens of thousands of people, perhaps hundred thousands, maybe even more, accepted Islam through his efforts. And this is undoubtedly in his mizan hasanat, inshallah. You know, all the good deeds of those people who followed him. So undoubtedly, this is a great virtue. Whoever, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, for somebody to accept Islam through you is better than anything in this world. Better than any luxury in this world, just one person to be guided through you. For Allah to guide one person through you. So here, undoubtedly, Yunus alayhi salam had that virtue of having many followers over 100,000. Back to the story here where we said Yunus alayhi salam had left his people and he had embarked upon Al-Fulkil Mashhoon, on this overloaded ship. And it is mentioned, and as Allah mentions in the Quran, فَسَاهَمَا, that what had happened was, it's an overloaded ship and there were great big waves that were coming and the ship was sinking. They could not continue with the journey. They had to remove weight from the ship. And so the only thing that they had was to tell the people, who were already so many people on the ship, somebody has to go. And to make it fair, فَسَاهَمَا, they would draw lots. They would draw lots to see which one, whoever picks the unfortunate lock, the lot, is their time to go. And then Allah says, فَسَاهَمَ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُدْحَضِينَ. And here some of the Mufassirin, they mention that Yunus alayhi salam, he picked and he drew the lot and it came on his name, meaning he is the one to be thrown overboard. And when it came, according to the Mufassirin, the people of the ship, they knew that he was a Nabi of Allah, or they knew that he was a man of virtue at least. So they said, no, this is not right, let's do it again. So they did it the second time, and Yunus alayhi salam, again, his name comes up. They did it a third time, and at that time, he got ready to go over. He said, this is something that Allah has decreed, that it's got to be me. And so he, فَسَاهَمَ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُدْحَضِينَ. So they drew the lots, and Yunus was the one to be thrown overboard. And as he's thrown overboard, of course we know, فَالْتَقَمُهُ الْحُوتُ وَهُوَ مُلِيمٌ. The whale, the great big whale came and engulfed him, or swallowed him whole. Swallowed him whole, Yunus alayhi salam. And here, subhanAllah, according to some of the ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this whale, Allah had ordered it not to bite any flesh, not to take any flesh from Yunus alayhi salam, and not to break any bones. And some people will come and try to say, oh, this is scientifically not possible and all this. We say the one who created those laws of physics and biology is able to stop those laws as well. So Allah here had prevented and ordered, commanded the whale that is subservient to Allah, the whale that must listen to Allah. Everything in the creation of Allah is subservient and obedient to Allah. And so this whale was commanded not to tear any flesh nor to break any bones. And as Yunus alayhi salam was casted and thrown into this whale, into the belly of this whale, he felt as if he had died straight away. Who would not feel that they'd been thrown into the belly of a whale? Immediately he felt as if he was dead. And then he tried to move his limbs and they moved. So he realized that he was alive. And what is the first thing that he does? Yasjud lillah. Goes down into sujood. He doesn't start getting excited and shouting and say, let me try to find a way out of here, or I'm still alive, or none of that. Fasajad. He immediately goes into sujood. And look at what he says. Ya Rabb, ittakhadtu laka masjidan fi mawdi' lam ya'budka ahadun fi mithlihi. He said, oh my Lord, I have taken for your sake, I have taken a place of worship, a masjid, a place where I've made sujood, in a place that no person before me has ever made sujood. He was so grateful to Allah that Allah has given him the tawfiq to pray salah in a place that nobody else would have never even imagined of doing so. And so, Yunus alayhi salam here, what do we see? The gratitude of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, alayhi salatu wasalam, Nabi Allah Yunus. Look at the gratitude that he had, that I'm alive. First thing that he says, alhamdulillah, look, not only am I alive, but alhamdulillah, Allah has given me the ability to worship him in a place that nobody else has worshipped. This was the hem. This was the concern of the Anbiya of Allah. And at this moment, as Allah mentions in the Quran, فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ. When he had left his people, he thought that Allah would not restrain him. He thought what he was doing was the right thing. He thought that Allah is not going to stop him, or Allah is not going to restrain him or prevent him from his rizq. Because this is a prevention of rizq, being stopped and being put in the whale. And then Allah says in the Quran, فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ. And then Yunus in the darkness. And here Allah mentions ظلمات, plural. And we know in Arabic language, plural, it means you have to have at least how much? Three. Not four, three. Yeah, good. Three or more. ظلمات, that means the darkness, the depths of the darkness must be at least three. And the ulama, they mention Yunus alayhi salam. And I want you to just think about this for a moment. First of all, he is in the darkness of the belly of the whale. This is one darkness. Then he is also in the darkness of the sea. Subhanallah, when you look at the sea, and you especially the deep ocean, you can't see a few yards down. Why? Because of the darkness of the sea. So he's in the darkness of the belly of the whale, in the darkness of the sea, and in the darkness of the night. Three darknesses here. And at that moment, in that moment where he is stressed, distressed, in anguish, and he is in a moment of fear, not knowing what will happen, فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَلَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. What kind of dua would you, what kind of dua would me and you make in that situation? What would you say to Allah in that situation? And look at what kind of dua a Nabi of Allah says. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. That there is none that is worthy of worship besides you, O Allah. سُبْحَانَكَ. Glory be you to Allah. You are perfect. You are free from all imperfections. إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. I am the one who is in wrong. I am the one who wronged myself. And if you notice here, if you remember the story of Ayyub alayhi salam last week, Ayyub, same thing. أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. I've been afflicted with this pain, with this affliction, and you, oh Allah, you are the most merciful. Notice here the dua of the Anbiya. There is no direct call to Allah. When we ask from Allah, and we should. But the Anbiya of Allah, such is their relationship with their Creator, that they acknowledge who Allah is, realizing that Allah is the one, and I am no one. And they are the Anbiya of Allah. Ayyub alayhi salam, like we said, Allah, you are the most merciful, even though I'm in the state that I'm in. And look at this Yunus, in the most difficult situation that you could imagine, inside the whale, no hope for him, can't see any light, nothing. He can't see anything at all, in complete and depth, in the depth of the darkness. And what does he say? Wallah, you are the one who is perfect. You are the one who we should worship, and I am the one who was wrong. I am the one who has done wrong. And subhanallah, what does Allah say? فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. And so Allah accepted his dua. Allah accepted the dua that he made. فَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمْ. And Allah saved him from this anguish and from this difficult situation that he was in. And another ayah Allah says, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. That had Yunus not been from those who constantly glorify Allah, those who constantly make dhikr of Allah, had he not been from them, then he would have stayed in the belly of the whale until the day of judgment. And what is amazing about this, what is amazing about this is the hadith where Rasulullah ﷺ, he says to Abdullah ibn Abbas in the famous hadith, Ya ghulam inni yu'allimuka kalimat, he says, ta'arraf ila Allah ya'rifka, ya ta'arraf ila Allah fi ar-rakha ya'rifka fi ash-shiddah. That remember and get to know Allah in your time of ease, Allah will remember you in your time of difficulty and hardship. And so here, subhanAllah, look at this. Yunus alayhi salam, this is what the Mufassirin, they say. Before, of course, before he was swallowed by the whale and before all this had happened, كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ. He was from those who constantly glorified Allah. And so Allah, in return, gave him the guidance at the time of need. This does not mean that at the time of need, things are going to be all easy for you. It could be very difficult. It could be something that is extremely difficult. But the point here is that Allah will give you the guidance and allow your heart to be guided. And subhanAllah, if we look today, an example, live example in front of us, when we see, for example, like the people in Gaza, when they've been bombed and they've been, their family members have lost, and at that moment they show thabat, they show iman in Allah. This is because that inshallah they were people who remembered Allah when they had time of ease. And so when the time of difficulty came, Allah guided them to the right action. And this is what the same thing will happen with Yunus alayhi salam. When the darkness happened and all these difficulties happen, Allah guides him to say the best of words, La ilaha illa anta subhanak, inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And there's an amazing hadith here that is authentic, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions about what happened. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in fact, sorry, let's mention the context, because there's a lot of lessons from this context. The hadith is narrated, or the athar is narrated by Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, one of the great sahaba, one of the early companions who accepted Islam. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he said, مررت بعثمان ابن عفان في المسجد فسلمت عليه. He said, I went past, and this is after Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away, at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Bismillah. And he said, I went past Uthman ibn Affan, another great companion, and again one of the early companions of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And I gave him salam. فَمَلَأَ عَيْنَهُ مِنِّي ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرُدْ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. And he stared at me like this, but he did not reply to my salam. Just looking at me instead, and he didn't reply to my salam. فَأَتَيْتُ عُمَرَ بْنِ الْخَطَّابِ. So I went to the leader of the believers, Umar ibn al-Khattab. And I told him that, you know, I went past. He said, هَلْ حَدَثَ فِي السَّلَامِ شَيْءٍ. He says, has something new happened with the salam? Is there some update on the salam? It's a rhetorical question. Obviously, he knows the answer. And Umar al-Khattab says, لا وما ذاك. He says, no, what is the issue? He said, إِلَّا أَنِّي مَرَرْتُ بِعُثْمَانَ آنِفًا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ فَمَلَأَ عَيْنَيْهِ مِنِّي ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرُدْ عَلَيَّ السَّلَامِ. He said, the only thing that happened is that I went past Uthman ibn Affan. He's in the masjid. I give him salams. He's staring at me, and he does not reply the salam to me. فَأَرْسَلَ عُمَرَ إِلَى عُثْمَانَ فَدَعَى. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, he calls Uthman ibn Affan, and he brings him. And look at this. When you have an issue, you come to the Imam of the Muslimin. You come to the one who is in authority, the one who has knowledge. When you have an issue with your brother, you take it up. Look at the Sahaba, they didn't want to have issues, they wanted to have them resolved. So he calls Uthman ibn Affan, Umar ibn Khattab, he calls Uthman ibn Affan. فَقَالَ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَكُونَ رَدَدْتَ عَلَىٰ أَخِيكَ السَّلَامِ. So he holds him to account. This is the right of the Muslim upon the other. And sometimes, wallah, it's so sad, you walk into a masjid, assalamu alaykum, and almost nobody replies to your salam. Or you see a brother on the road, assalamu alaykum, he doesn't want to reply to your salam. Or a sister sees another sister in the shop, assalamu alaikum, and she doesn't reply to the salam. Or they will replace it with hi or hello, because we're amongst non-Muslims. That level of lack of izzah you have of your deen, you have the best greeting that Allah has given you. The greeting that Allah gave to Adam alayhi salam. Assalamu alaikum. So here anyway, going back to the story, he said, what stopped you from giving your brother salam? And here, look at, it's interesting here. Uthman ibn Affan, what does he say? He says, ma fa'alt. Sa'ad, I didn't do that. I didn't not reply to his salam. And Sa'ad said, bala, hatta halafa wa halaft. He said, I told him, you did. You heard me. You looked at me. And he said, I swore by Allah. And he swore by Allah. He swore by Allah that he didn't give me salam. And Sa'ad ibn Waqqas said, I swore by Allah that you did give salam. To show you here what? SubhanAllah, this happens sometimes. You know, sometimes somebody's there and he's daydreaming or he's not with it there and you give him salam. Sometimes give him the benefit of the doubt also. Give them the benefit of the doubt that the brother didn't hear you. Sometimes this happens. Sometimes, SubhanAllah, you're staring at someone and you're thinking your mind is elsewhere. He might say something to you and you didn't reply back to him. This will happen with Uthman ibn Affan. So of course, it's going to happen with us who are much less than him. And so, at that moment, ثم قال بلى وأستغفر الله وأتوب إليه إنك مررت بي آنفا وأنا أحدث نفسي بكلمة سمعتها من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. He said, at a moment afterwards, Uthman ibn Affan, he said, I remembered at that moment. And he said, أستغفر الله وأتوب إليه. I ask Allah for forgiveness and I turn to him in repentance. You did go past me. And I did see you, but I was so busy thinking of something that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said. So my mind was occupied by something that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And here, and this is, subhanAllah, it shows you the beautiful relationship between the Sahaba. At that moment, look at what Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he said. So he said I was occupied by what? By something that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And then, he said, لا والله ما ذكرتها قط إلا تغشى بصري وقلبي غشاوة. He said, I can't remember it. There's something over my heart or my sight that I just can't remember. I was really trying to remember. So here, look, subhanAllah, it was actually a very good thing that he was busy with. He's trying to think of something that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, but he just can't think of it. And at that moment, Sa'ad said, so I said to him, فَأَنَا أُنَبِّئُكَ بِهَا. I am going to tell you about it. Look at this, subhanAllah. Sa'ad ibn Waqqas, the love that he had with his brother, Uthman ibn Affan, he even knows what he's thinking about. He even knows what he's thinking about. Why? Because these were the what? They were the early Sahaba. They were the Sahaba that accepted Islam when everybody was against Islam. They were the Sahaba that accepted Islam when it was not easy to accept Islam. When it meant you're going to be outcasted, it meant you're going to be tortured. So they went through tough times. And that's why Sa'd ibn Waqqas said, I know exactly what you were thinking about and I'll tell you what you were talking about. He said, إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذكر لنا أول دعوة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he mentioned to us the start of the دعوة. ثم جاء عربي فشغله حتى قام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاتبعته. So رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was with the companions in the early stages of Islam, and he was telling them a دعاء. And he only started off until a Bedouin came, and he the Bedouins, they're not known for their mannerisms and things like that. So he came and he interrupted, and Rasulullah ﷺ became busy with him until he left. And as he was leaving, Sa'd ibn Waqqas said, I followed him. I followed Rasulullah ﷺ until he reached to his house and he was about to enter. فَضَرَبْتُ قَدْ بِقَدَمَيْ. So I stamped my feet onto the ground. Look, he was even scared or worried and out of the love of Rasulullah ﷺ that he didn't want to even call his name out. And so he stamped the ground to get his attention. This is the love and respect that they had for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he stamped the ground. فَالْتَفَتَ إِلَيَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam turns back to Sa'd ibn Waqqas. He says, "Man hadha Abu Ishaq?" Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Who is this? Is it Abu Ishaq, who's the title of the nickname of Sa'd ibn Waqqas?" قَالَ قُلْتُ نَعَمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. He said, "Yes, O Messenger of Allah, it's me." قَالَ فَمَا. So he said, "What's the matter?" Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is asking Sa'd, "What is the matter?" And then he said, لا والله إلا أنك ذكرت لنا أول دعوة ثم جاء هذا الأعرابي فشغلك. He said, there's nothing, O Messenger of Allah, except that you mentioned to us the start of a dua, and then this Bedouin came and he got us busy from you and he got you busy from us? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, na'am, yes. Da'awatu dhinnun idh huwa fi batni al-hut. It is the dua of the man of the whale, Yunus alayhi salam, when he was in the belly of that whale. La ilaha illa anta subhanak inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And he mentions the dua of Yunus alayhi salam. فإنه لم يدع بها مسلم ربه في شيء في شيء قط إلا استجاب له. And he said, no Muslim will ever make this dua. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. No Muslim makes this dua in anything at all except that Allah will answer. Allah will answer your dua if you make this dua. And subhanAllah, that's why, what does Allah say? فاستجبنا له, and Allah answered his dua. فاستجبنا له فنجيناه من الغم, and we saved him from the difficult thing that he was in. وكذلك ننجي المؤمنين, and also we will save who? We'll save the believers. Meaning, if the believers who come after Yunus, they say the same dua that Allah loves, Allah will also save them like He saved Yunus عليه السلام. And another narration, Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من دعا بدعاء يونس استجيب له. Whoever makes the dua of Yunus, then it will be answered from him. وكذلك ننجي المؤمنين. This is a promise from Allah. And thus, we will save the believers as well that make this dua. So subhanAllah, here is an amazing lesson that we can learn from this dua. The dua that is when you're in the most difficult time, when you're in a time of despair, when you're in a time where you feel that there's no hope, this is a dua that the believer should make. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. طيب, after this happened, we know then that of course Allah saved him. وكذلك فاستجبنا له فنجيناه من الغم. Allah saved him from this. فنبذناه بالعراء. And Allah mentions, and so they got the whale to cast him out into the open shore. And it said that this open shore, there was no like living things or anything like that. There was no people about, no infrastructure, not even vegetation. And Allah said, وَهُوَ سَقِيمٌ. And he was ill. Imagine being in the whale. Allahu a'lam how long. Some people said it was the whole day. Some people said 3 days. Some people went as far as to say 40 days. And Allah knows best. But even being for a few moments in the belly of a whale is something that is frightening, let alone what it can do to your body. So he is, of course, like in a very difficult situation. He's ill. He's feeling sick. And Allah has now saved him and put him onto the shore. And وَأَنْبَتْنَا عَلَيْهِ شَجَرَةً مِّنْ يَقْطِينَ. And subhanAllah, here is an amazing thing. Allah, he came to a land, بِالْعَرَاء, an open shore where there's no vegetation, nothing. وَأَنْبَتْنَا عَلَيْهِ شَجَرَةً مِّنْ يَقْطِينَ. And Allah made what grow from there? يَقْطِين. يَقْطِين could mean either two things. It could either mean what is known for today as pumpkin, or I think they call it squash or something like that, which is the vegetable that grows from the ground, not from the trees. Grows from ground up. Or it could be from the word يقطين الأرض, meaning it is something that comes or sprouts out from the earth. So like a watermelon, this would be considered a type of يقطين. Anything that grows from the ground up would be considered يقطين. Some of the Sahaba, there's narrations of them mentioning that it was a دباء, which we know today as pumpkin, pumpkin. And so here, but look what Allah says, وَأَنْبَتْنَا عَلَيْهِ شَجَرَةً مِّنْ يَقْطِينَ. That from this is a lesson for Yunus. He's come to a land that is barren, and Allah grows from it this yaqteen, this pumpkin up from the ground. To say, Yunus, you are in a place where there was no hope, all despair, in that darkness. And how, look how Allah saved you. Likewise, here, look, this land is barren. Here Allah has grown for him the pumpkin to get your nourishment from. طيب. And of course, after that, then we know that Yunus alayhi salam, he went back to his people. And as we mentioned, who can remember how many of his people? What does Allah say in the Quran? How many of his people? How many did he have? Bismillah. To Elfin? Oh, Yazidun. 100,000 and more. 100,000 and more. And he's come to them now, and they are all believers in Allah. They have all accepted the message of Islam. They have all accepted La ilaha illallah. To finish off, I just want to mention one thing. On this ayah, when Allah says, فَاجْتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَجَعَلَهُ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Here, a lesson of being, of having perseverance as well. Allah says to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, فاصبر لحكم ربك. Wait for the ruling and the command of your Lord. ولا تكن كصاحب الحوت. And don't be like the companion of the whale. Who of course the story that happened. And then Allah says, فاجتباه ربه فجعله من الصالحين. That Allah chose him. Allah selected him. Why? Because of the heart that he had, the iman that he had, and Allah made him from those who are salihin. Here is important, the ayah that Allah mentions. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا يَنْبَغِي لِعَبْدٍ أَنْ يَقُولَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ يُونُسِ بْنُ مَتَّى. He said, it is not befitting for somebody to say that I, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is better than Yunus ibn Matta. Even because when you hear the story of Yunus alayhi salam, Allah says, وَهُوَ mulim, he was blameworthy. So a person might start to say, oh, you know, he's not a good person or something like this. No, Allah is teaching us a lesson. He was a human at the end of the day and he made a mistake. But that does not take away from his status with Allah. And that is why Allah says, فَجَعَلَهُ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And rather, فَجْتَبَى, that Allah chose him. And he made him from the صالحين. And this is only from the tawadu of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Even we know in the other narration where one of the companions said that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi is better than Musa. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi said, don't do this preference. Although we know that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi undoubtedly is the best of all humanity. He's the best of all the Anbiya and Rusul. But this is from the humility of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that he didn't like in his face that you're saying, you're better than Isa, you're better than Musa, alayhim as-salam. So here, this is Rasulullah ﷺ showing tawadu. And here I want to mention one thing that reminds me of another hadith where Allah says, لَوْلَا أَن تَدَارَكَهُ نِعْمَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ لَنُبِذَ بِالْعَرَاءِ وَهُوَ مَذْمُومٌ. That had it not been for the blessing of Allah on Yunus, then he would have been left in that whale and cast out. Here, subhanAllah, look at this. A Nabi of Allah, a Nabi of Allah, somebody who has iman better than any of us can imagine. But Allah says, لَوْلَا أَن تَدَارَكَهُ نِعْمَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ. Had it not been for the blessing of Allah engulfing him and being upon him. To show you that if the Anbiya of Allah need the ni'mah of Allah to be guided, then what about me and you? And this is why Rasulullah ﷺ said, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ. Nobody enters Jannah بِعَمَلِهِ, with his action. Except through what? The mercy of Allah. And what did the Sahaba say? وَلَا أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Not even you, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa, the best of all mankind, the one who has maqaman mahmudan, who has the most noble status with Allah, he said, not even you, ya Rasulullah. He said, wala ana illa an yataghammadani Allah bi rahmatihi. Not even me, except that Allah has his mercy upon me. And so this is to show you that the mercy and the blessing of Allah is uncountable, something that is great and beyond us. That no matter what we do, we can never pay back Allah. We cannot even pay back our own parents. How do you expect to pay back Allah? How do you expect to pay back Allah for the blessings that He has given us? هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.